I heard one of the microphones on the bench.
The what?
The microphone.
The microphone's on the bench. I don't know. Makes a great hymn.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Orange United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Corey, and I am one of the associate ministers here at Orange. We are so grateful that God has led you to this place this morning, and we are grateful. We know that it's been a busy holiday season, and so if this is your first time back in a few weeks, we welcome you back. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we welcome you. We have a gift for you. Our usher, Liz Moore, in the back, would love to give you as you leave this morning. I want to remind everyone that in the sanctuary, there are no facilities, so if you are in need of any during the service, you can actually exit out the back doors and come up this pathway into this side door right here, and down the hall to your right, you will find them there if you are in need. Before we transition into our time of worship, we have a few announcements that we want to draw your attention to. The first is, if you're worshiping with us online, you can fill out the online attendance pad that's present in the comment section. If you're worshiping with us in person, there is a pew pad at the end of your row that we would love to have you fill out just to let us know you're here. And if you have not been receiving our bi-weekly emails, we would love to have your email address so that we can send those to you. That has all the details of everything that's happening in the life of the church, special announcements, those things. So please take a moment and fill that out. Let us know you are here. The announcements we'd like to share with you is, first, our Backpack Buddy program, which is a program that feeds food insecure elementary school students at an elementary school in Hillsboro over the weekend. We send them home with a backpack full of food on Friday to make it to Monday. We are in dire need of supplies for that program. So if you could take a moment, and if you are at the store or if you want to place an Amazon order, anything like that, and have it delivered to the church, we would love to have some of those donations to restock our supplies so that we can continue that ministry. Similarly, we have another ministry called Share the Love Bags, where we pack bags to give to folks in need in our community with supplies in them, a bottle of water, a pair of socks, a pair of gloves, a mask, food that doesn't perish. We are having a Share the Love Bag put together party. So that is this Thursday, January 12th at 1 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. So if you'd like to come and be a part of that, we'd love to have you join us. Also, this Sunday tonight is our first youth group of the new year. So if you are a youth ages 6th grade to 12th grade, middle school meets at 4:30 and senior high meets, or high school meets, at 6 o'clock, and they have a dinner together. I heard it was a macaroni and cheese bar tonight. So, I mean, can I pass for you? No? Okay. So that'll be this evening as well. Please come for that. We do want to make a note as well. Our blood drives are getting kicked back off for this year, and we're going to have one January 18th. That's a Wednesday from 10 to 2:30. If you want to volunteer to serve and help with folks coming in, getting snacks, things like that, that's wonderful. If you'd like to donate, we'd love to have you do that as well. The last one is that you received in the mail a pledge card for this coming year for the church, and you can also access it online. If you had a time to discern and think about how you'd like to make a commitment this year, we would love for you to either send that in, drop it at the church, or to fill out that online form. No one has access to that except for our financial secretary, Sheila, so it is a secure form if you fill it out online. Just a reminder for that. I know there is a lot happening. It's always exciting time as we do begin this new year of 2023. And so I invite you to stand together in body or in spirit as we join in one voice in our call to worship that is either on the screen or in your bulletin. God's voice speaks to our chaos, echoing in our empty hearts. God's voice flows like the living waters of grace.
Our new name, blood, resounding in our souls.
God's voice stirs the waters of baptismal hope, calling us to be bearers of peace to a world of broken hopes. Please remain standing as we join to sing Come Christians Joy to Sing, number 158 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
remain standing as we join for the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, page 881, or again, the words are on your screen. Let us join together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Each week we pay close attention to the list of names in our bulletin under the prayer list, and we update these names as we receive information from you. And so if you have a name you'd like to add, or if you have an update about a name that's listed, please submit that to us either in the pew pad or to the email that's listed there. We do have a few additions. First, this is an announcement and a prayer concern as well. Our secretary, our office receptionist, Evan Stansel, his grandmother passed away, and the funeral is this weekend, and so we are going to have the church office closed tomorrow. He will be out for that. And so just a reminder that the church office will be closed tomorrow, but please hold Evan and his family in your prayers as they mourn and grieve that loss. I also ask you to please pray for our family, Tiagin's Aunt Sue. Sue Wood is her name, passed away this morning. And so we hold his family, especially his mom, in prayer, as this is a difficult loss for them, and continued prayers for them as they make preparations in the midst of this. So Sue Wood and Evan Stansel's family, please add. We continue to lift up the following names: Sue Wallace, Dennis Dahlke, Martha Clark, Shirley and John Madry, John Harrell, Martha Jarrett, Rosalind Thompson, Kent Manny, Zolda Pendergraf, Pat Davis, Lacey Gerard, Paul Mann, Ray Mann, and Mickey Rogerson. I encourage you to use this as a guide in your prayer life. Let us go to God. This morning, as we pray for the world that God loves and the church God calls, and all people according to their needs, we ask that at the bidding of Lord in your mercy, you respond, hear our prayer. God of light and darkness, through water and word, you shine your light into the darkness of our lives. We give thanks for this incredible gift. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of love, your love comes in spite of our animosity. You bring reconciliation to those who are divided. We pray for better relations between nations. Strengthen us to be peacemakers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of hope and fear, you walk with us through the challenges which surround us. God, ease our anxiety by your promised presence and set us free from the despair we experience. Lord, in your mercy, God of church and world, in baptism you unify yourself with our world and you bring your reign into being. Keep us from seeing your love as a hiding place. Motivate us to infuse the world with your justice. Lord, in your mercy, God of health and wholeness, there is nothing that separates us from your love. Inspire us to bring your health to the sick, your encouragement to the discouraged, your promise to the dying, especially those we name in our hearts before you now. Lord, in your mercy, And God of life and of death, all that exists is from you and for you. Enable us to trust your baptismal promise and serve this hurting world. Lord, in your mercy. God who shines in the darkness, receive these prayers and the prayers of our hearts in the name of the one who is your light, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand in body or spirit as we sing our hymn of preparation, Sweet, Sweet Spirit, page 334, or again, the words are on the screen.
Be seated. Good morning, church. I'm Adam Seat, the lead pastor here at Orange, and I welcome you. Thank you for being a part of this time of worship, those that are worshiping here in person and those that have joined us online. I invite you to join with me now in our prayer for illumination as the words are found printed in your bulletin. They're also found up on the screen. Let us pray. Guide us, O God, by your word and Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes to us from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. I invite you to turn with me in your own Bible, or you can use the Bible there that is there in the pew in front of you. In that pew Bible, it is found on page number 3 in the New Testament section. Again, Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Hear now these words. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." This is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us go to God in prayer. God of grace and God of mercy, we give thanks for the opportunity for us to share together in this time of worship. We come needing renewal. We come recognizing that we have fallen short and missed the mark. We come as those who declare that we are aligned with you. And so as we come as your people, Lord, may you speak to us this morning. By the power of your Holy Spirit, would you transform the words that proceed from my mouth, and as they fall upon our ears and penetrate our hearts, may they be changed into a word of God that we need to hear today, as individuals and collectively as one body. Lord, we pray this in the name of Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people said, amen. A few years ago, I was having confirmation class at the church that I was serving. One of the students that was a part of that class had not been baptized before. And so this student wanted to be able to participate in that same opportunity to be confirmed in front of the church, but they first wanted to be baptized. Now, the thing was, this student did not want to be baptized in the way that we typically do in the Methodist Church. You've seen it done probably numerous times where we offer the sprinkling of water. However, this student wanted to be immersed. The thing was, confirmation was going to take place in early May, and if you know anything about the state of North Carolina and our weather, it's not always very warm at that time of the year. And they had a very specific place that they wanted this baptism to take place. They wanted this baptism to take place. Their family had a place on the Neuse River in an area called Kennel Beach, and they wanted to be baptized there on the pier down on the water, and they wanted to be immersed. Again, early May in North Carolina, and it just so happened that that day, that Saturday, it was going to be a bit cold. Now, I tried to speak to the student and say, you know, there are other ways we could do this. We could go to the indoor pool at the Y and use that. We could contact another church that has a baptistry that might allow us to utilize that space. I tried to negotiate other ways. We could do this in August, I even tried to propose. But the student wanted the baptism and wanted to be a part of that confirmation service on that Sunday. And so I agreed, and sure enough, we made our way down to eastern North Carolina, and it was cold. Walked down to the water before we were to do the baptism, and I went down and dipped my toe in there, and it was cold. Now, the thing was, the water itself was actually warmer than the air that we were in, but that doesn't make a difference when the water is still cold to you. And so I dipped my toe in that water, and I really tried to renegotiate. But we were insistent. So the family, we all gathered around on this pier. And as we had gathered around, I went through the motions of sharing the question, asking the questions that we ask anytime we baptize anyone. You've heard those questions numerous times here. And the family was gathered and supported. Members of the church had even driven out there to be there, close family, friends. And they were all gathered. And it finally got time where all the questions had been answered, and I had to get into the water. And so I got to the ladder and climbed down into the water. And something happened. The water wasn't cold. I got into the water, and I looked up onto the pier, and Rainey said, "Is it cold?" I said, "Come on in. The water's fine." And she climbed down, and I baptized her, immersing her, going under the water and lifting her up. And then we climbed out of the water. That's when I really noticed how cold it was. But the strange thing was that moment. I mean, I had touched the water before. I knew how cold the water was. But when we got in for the baptism, that water was no longer cold. I can't explain it. Something happened. I believe it was the Spirit was washing over us. There was, maybe it was adrenaline rush was going on in the body, but neither one of us felt that the water was cold until then when we got out, we noticed. It was something powerful that happens at baptism. At baptism, whether you are baptized as an infant or you are baptized as an adult or you're baptized as a teenager or somebody that has come to this point of making the decision about baptism, something powerful happens at your baptism. One, there are several things that do happen. One of those is that baptism is an indication that you are now initiated into the household of faith, into the body of Christ, the church. You are initiated through the baptism. Now, some of you might have gone through initiation through a sports team or a fraternity, sorority. This is different kind of initiation. This is that mark that you are now in the body of Christ. You are a part of that family, household of faith. Another thing that happens at baptism is this sign of repentance and inner cleansing from sin. It's this acknowledgement that we are sinners in need of grace. And it's that stepping forward, repenting of our sin to be washed clean, to be made whole. And at our baptism, it represents this new birth in life, in the life of the believer. This image of dying to self, to live through Christ. That's why I do find it such a powerful image when someone is baptized in immersion, because they die to self. They go under the waters, almost covering like a grave, to be raised to live through Christ. And baptism is a mark of Christian discipleship. It is Christ placing his mark upon our lives. Often, we'll explain baptism to a child in the way of saying, asking them if they know whose Bible this is. And they say, well, it's yours, because you're holding it. Thank you for stating the obvious. I say, no, whose Bible is this? Take a look. And on the front, it has my name, that my mother-in-law had it put there, and this Bible was given to me as a gift when I was ordained. And so I tell them, my name is upon this Bible. It's been marked. It's mine. And that's what happens at baptism. Christ marks you. We receive the mark of Christ upon our hearts and our lives. That is baptism that we have experienced. And when you were baptized, I want to ask real quick, how many were baptized as an infant? I was, yeah. I see a few of those. How many were baptized as a teenager? I see a few of those, yeah. How many were baptized as an adult? All right, yeah. Most of the time, if someone is baptized, they're baptized many times before the age of 30, but sometimes we're presented as a child. I don't remember my baptism at all, but I sure remember my son's baptisms. I don't remember my baptism, but I remember my confirmation when I accepted that baptism which had been given to me, and it was made firm within my heart. And when we are baptized and we receive those benefits, we receive becoming a part of the body of Christ, we receive that mark upon our lives, we receive that new life. When we are baptized, we're following the example of Jesus Christ. As today is Baptism of the Lord Sunday, and we're being reminded of that baptism and understanding what it means for us. Now, in that baptism, Jesus was following in a basic ritual tradition that is found commonly within the Jewish faith. When someone would be made unclean, perhaps they touched a dead animal and had to be separated, they would be made unclean, and so they are thus separated from the community for a period of prescribed amount of time. But when that time has come up, they then could come to the rabbi and ask for the ritualistic cleansing, this washing, and then after that time of being made unclean, they were once again made clean and were allowed to be brought back into the community, back into the family. And so Jesus was going through this model of coming to John the Baptist. As John the Baptist is out in the wilderness, he's preaching this baptism, but it's a different kind of baptism. It's not just the ritualistic cleansing. It's not just the being made clean from having been unclean. It's about repenting, about fully turning back to Christ, to God. It's about fully submitting to God's will. And so the Pharisees and the Sadducees are there trying to make sure everything's going just right. They themselves would never be baptized because they themselves would not repent in the way that John was asking. But Jesus comes. Jesus comes. He who was without sin, Jesus comes to be baptized. And as I read those scriptures, you heard how John at first tried to get out of it. No, no, I'm not the one that should baptize you. You're the one that should baptize me. Because he knew. But Jesus says that this must be done in order to fulfill all righteousness. And so John relents. He welcomes Jesus into the water. He baptizes him. And once again, something amazing happens at that baptism. They see a vision of like a dove that descends. And this voice from heaven that says, "This is my son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased." And Jesus then proceeds immediately after his baptism to go into the wilderness for this his time of temptation and trial. See, baptism for Jesus, it was the start of everything that was else to come. It was the start. This baptism was that moment where Jesus fully offered himself to fulfill all that the scriptures had been told. Jesus comes. He identifies with all of humanity and our brokenness and our need to repent. And he himself is washed clean. For us, that model, that being reminded of, that's the beginning. That's a starting point. That's not the end. That's the beginning of this journey and walking in the body of Christ. And here we are 2,000 years later, and we still live into what it means to be a child of God within the kingdom of God. And I bet you've witnessed enough baptisms to know that there are those questions that we always ask. And the very first question that we ask and when someone is baptized, and we're going to be considering all of these questions over the next few weeks. The first question that is asked, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Recognize when Jesus offered himself for this baptism, he himself was renouncing that the forces of this world had no power over him, that he rejected the evil powers of this world. He repented of humanity's sin. And when we remember our baptism, we are reminded of that covenant, that vow that we took, that we too would renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of our sin. Over this week, as I've been preparing for this message, I kept thinking about what are the ways that we live into that vow. I really internalized and made it personal in the ways that I thought, how do I live a life that renounces the spiritual forces of wickedness? How do I reject the evil powers of this world? How do I repent of my sin? Well, I started thinking about that in the context of, like, the new year. You know, I don't make resolutions because I already know that by the end of January, they're not going to be worth anything in my life. I've never been able to keep up a resolution. But I really did try to think, what if I started this week trying to really live into renouncing the spiritual forces of wickedness, saying that those spiritual forces of wickedness that are out there have no power over me. Maybe it's social media, but maybe it's TV. Maybe it's the things that we read online. Maybe it's the people that we surround ourselves with sometimes. How can I eliminate some of those spiritual forces of wickedness? How can I demonstrate that I renounce them? What if it meant that for me to reject the evil powers of this world? You know, I have found that there are sometimes that things of this world have power over me that I wish they never did. I watched a basketball game this week that made me so absolutely livid I wanted to throw the remote control. Yeah. I'll state my case later. I don't want those things to have power over my life. I don't want those things to take what could have been a good day and to ruin it. I want those things to no longer. I reject the evil powers of this world. I do not want those things to have a hold on me. And I acknowledge I'm a sinner in need of God's grace. And I repent. I turn back. I want to live into this. I want to live into this vow. I want to live a life truly renouncing the spiritual forces of wickedness. I want to reject all the evil powers of this world that take hold of us. And I repent. over these next few weeks, I invite you to remember your baptism. Find out more about it if you don't remember it. I want to invite you to remember your baptism. And in fact, there's going to be opportunities at the end of this series. We're going to close with a baptismal remembrance service where you'll be able to be reminded of renewing that covenant once again. But today, when we sing our closing song, I want to give you an opportunity to remember your baptism. As this baptismal font is so beautiful, it's something that is a reminder of those that have come before us. It's been here a long time, and we are thankful for all the lives who were made new through the waters of baptism here in this place. And so I invite you today, when we get to that closing hymn, if you feel so led, I invite you to come forward. Touch the waters. You can take the water and make the sign of a cross on your head if you'd like. Let this be a part of the way that we are this week going to live into rejecting, renouncing, and repenting, claiming we, by the waters of Christ, are made whole. We are washed clean. We become a beloved, a child of God. Let us pray. Oh, Lord, in your grace and mercy, you offered your Son to be a sacrifice, to pay a price for us that we ourselves could never pay. You welcome us into the community of faith through the waters of baptism. The vows that we made or were made on our behalf, and then we accepted and made ourselves, are vows that we still hold true. And as that mark has been placed upon us, may we ever so intently live into those vows. May we seek to find the spiritual forces of wickedness within our lives, and may we renounce them. May we discern the evil powers of this world and the hold that it has on us. May we reject them. And all of the sins that have infiltrated our hearts and minds, we repent. Today, may we live even more faithfully into the vows that we made through the waters of baptism. We pray this in the name of Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, amen. I continue to give thanks for the way that you enabled this church to be a church that helps people find their place in God's story. You do that through the way that you serve and through the way that you give. Pastor Corey shared earlier some of the ways that you have an opportunity to serve and to give. For those of you that are worshiping here in person, there is a basket at the back of the church. If you feel so led to place a contribution, I invite you to do so. I also have the opportunity to share that online there at orangemethodist.org/give. You can make your contribution there. Thank you for all the ways that you continue to help us be a church that helps people find their place in God's story. Doris Click and Don the Page Turner. Let us stand as we sing together our doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Our hymn of going forth is hymn number 351, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. And again, I'd like to invite you, if you feel so led, you're welcome to come forward. If you cannot reach over the altar rail, you're welcome to come up the steps, touch the waters, and be reminded of the vows that we have made. Let us sing together. Special word of appreciation once again to Doris for sharing the special music with us. We also give thanks for Sherry Handfinger, who is accompanying our hymns today. So thank you so much. Thank you for being a part of this time that we share together in worshiping our Lord and Savior. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, may you go forth out into the world, renouncing, rejecting, and repenting in such a way that leads others to come to know the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.